Jake woke up quickly, startled, which was the only way he woke up these days. It was particularly cold this morning, but it could be worse. Jake had been staying in an abandoned house recently, which was better than sleeping in a stairwell or on a park bench. Things hadn't always been this way for him, and at times, he still questioned himself on how he ended up here. Just 2 short years ago, Jake was living with his parents as he attended college. He had a decent part-time job, and overall, things really couldn't have been going better. His home life was great. He had good, loving parents who provided him with a nice life as he grew up. He got into a good college after graduating from high school and kept up good grades. And then, everything changed. It started one night after he was invited to a party off campus. There was a girl in one of his classes that he had been attracted to. They would occasionally talk during class, but were in no way considered friends. So when the girl, Krista, invited him to the party, he was both surprised and excited. Upon arriving at the party, there were far more people there than Jake was anticipating. So many, in fact, that he almost decided to just leave and go home. A decision he still regrets not going through with to this very day. He awkwardly walked in through the crowd of people at the party and eventually found a corner to go stand in. He proceeded to stand there and stare at his phone as if he were busy with something on it. But the truth was, at that moment, it might as well not even been on, as it was nothing more than a prop. Once Jake almost decided enough was enough and that it was time to go home, he heard a familiar voice. It was Krista, who seemed overly excited about his presence, although he contributed a lot of the excitement to the alcohol that she had clearly consumed prior to his arrival. Nonetheless, he finally had someone to talk to, and that was good enough for him. Taking him by the hand, Krista pulled Jake into another room, where she showed him where the drinks were. After having a few drinks with Krista, Jake found himself not only comfortable, but actually having a good time. They partied and drank for hours, until they found themselves being 2 out of the small handful of people left at the party. What happened next seemed to change Jake's life from there on out. One of the people at the party pulled out a small baggie, poured some powder from it onto a mirror, cut it into lines, and started passing it around. Jake had never really done any drugs in the past and wasn't sure what it is, but he assumed it must have been coke. The idea of him doing any made him a bit uncomfortable, but his inhibitions were low from drinking, and after Krista did some and passed it to him, he felt pressured into it. He wanted nothing more at that very moment than for her to like him. But after doing the line that was passed to him, he found himself wanting something else instead. He wanted more. The party ended and Jake went back to his life, but he kept finding himself thinking about that night, wanting to feel that way again. Eventually, he asked Krista about it, and he was horrified to find out that he had actually done heroin that night. What scared him even more was how much he liked it. Eventually, he convinced himself that he would be one of those people that could just do it every once in a while, and asked Krista if she could find him more. She gave him a phone number, and within 2 hours of him having the number, he was on his way home to finally feel that feeling again. For the next month, Jake would use the drug every weekend, but only on weekends. After that, he began to find it too hard to wait all week to feel that way, and started using it on weekends and also once in the middle of the week. That transitioned little by little to daily use. And once he started finding himself broke, noticed he had lost weight, and that he spent too much time thinking about it, he knew he had to quit using it altogether. At first, it went just fine. He got through the first day, and while he thought about it, he didn't actually go get any. The following day was different though. He woke up the second day very ill, and as the day progressed, he only found himself getting worse and worse. He at first thought he had the flu, and eventually, to take the edge off, he gave in and used. Upon using, all of his symptoms were alleviated within only a few minutes. It was at this point that he realized he didn't have the flu, but instead, he was going through withdrawals. Things got worse for Jake. He eventually lost his job due to him stealing to support his habit. After multiple failed detoxes and rehabs, his parents kicked him out of their house. By that point, Jake had also dropped out of school. For the past 6 months, Jake basically had the same routine every day. He would go into a large store, steal an item that had some decent value to it, and return it to a different store. Once he would collect the money from the returned item, he would go visit his dealer, go home and use, and do it all again the next day. This might not sound like enough to keep someone busy for an entire day, but at this point, Jake had no car, and doing all of this on foot took a long time. So at this point in time, it would be fair to say that Jake was basically waiting to die. He found no joy in using the drug anymore, but he had to use it, or else he would find himself deathly ill. He had no home, no car, no job, nothing. Eventually, the stores he visited grew wise to what he had been doing, and he was banned from entering them. Out of desperation, he then started stealing from random people. He typically would try to pick wallets from pockets or grab purses when no one was looking. Whatever was easiest, and whatever he thought he could get away with. One day, Jake was walking around downtown, looking for what appeared to be an easy target for him. He saw a well-dressed man walking down the street. He looked to be middle-aged, and more importantly, looked like he had money. He nonchalantly started walking behind the man, inching closer and closer to him. When they got to the corner of the street, Jake bumped into the man, quickly grabbing the man's wallet. He apologized to the man, saying, "I'm sorry, sir, I wasn't paying attention to where I was going." The man just gave him a look, and then Jake walked off. Once he felt like he was in the clear, he pulled the man's wallet out of his pocket and started counting how much money was in it. Maybe only a minute later, he was startled by the sound of screeching tires. Once he looked up to see where the noise was coming from, he found himself being forced into the back of a car by two men. Jake was panicked, asking who they were and what they were doing. Just then, he saw who was sitting in the front passenger seat of the car. It was the man whose wallet he had just taken. Realizing quickly that he had picked the wrong target, Jake handed the man the wallet and began apologizing over and over. "Who sent you?" the man asked. "What are you talking about?" replied Jake. "Who do you work for? Who sent you, and how did you find me?" Jake was at a loss. He had no idea what this man was talking about. "Listen, man," Jake said. "No one sent me. You look like the kind of guy that had money. I'm just a homeless heroin addict. I don't work for anyone. I don't even have a job." The two men in the back seat grabbed Jake's arms and rolled up his sleeves. They confirmed with the man in the front seat that there were clear track marks on Jake's arm and that he must have been telling the truth. "What do we do now?" one of the men asked. "I don't know," the man replied. "Let's just bring him to the boss and see what he decides." Jake began begging the men to just let him go and kept asking them who the boss was and where they were going. But from that point on, all of his pleas and questions went unanswered. Eventually, the men put a blindfold on Jake. They drove for what seemed to be another 45 minutes. Once parked, Jake was escorted out of the car and walked inside somewhere, at which point the blindfold was finally removed. Jake looked around and found himself in what appeared to be any ordinary-looking office building. Jake and the men stepped into an elevator and proceeded upwards. At this point, Jake had long since given up on pleading and asking questions. They went up several floors, walked down a hallway, and ended up in some sort of waiting room. The man from the front seat instructed Jake and the other men to wait. Several very long minutes went by, and he returned. He told Jake to come with him. At this point, Jake feared the worst. He knew how serious these men were, and that whoever the boss was must have been someone powerful. He was sure he was at the headquarters of the mob or something similar. He felt like his life was about to come to an end. On one hand, he was terrified of dying. On the other, he was relieved that this hell on earth his life had turned into would finally be over. The man walked Jake into a very nice, large office. There was a man sitting at the desk, staring at him as soon as they walked in. He was instructed to have a seat and was left there alone to face the boss. The boss started by saying, "So, I've heard that you have been giving a few of my men some unexpected excitement today." As much as Jake feared this man, he couldn't help but to feel at ease by how the man spoke to him. If Jake were to see this man out on the street, he would assume he was a nice, ordinary guy. Nothing about him, aside from the power he must have had, was at all threatening about him. Jake finally replied, saying, "It was all a misunderstanding. I was just trying to survive. I didn't mean to start any trouble. I promise I didn't." The boss seemed to study Jake for a while and finally said, "I'm going to ask you some questions, and I need you to answer them with 100% honesty." The boss then proceeded to ask Jake who he was, where he lived, who had come looking for him, and a bunch of other pretty standard questions. And Jake did answer them honestly, like he said he would. The boss ended up sitting there silently for several minutes. When he finally broke the silence, he said, "Okay, Jake, I believe you have answered everything I've asked with honesty, and for that I thank you. I sincerely feel bad for you and what you have been going through. I have known others that were stuck in an addiction, and I wouldn't wish that on anyone. I believe you ran into my associate by pure coincidence today, and that you were merely trying to survive. I'm going to give you two choices. I can give you a job. This job is very, very important. It must absolutely be kept a secret from any and everyone you come across. If you choose to work for me, you need to know you will be given tasks. Some will be very easy, while others may challenge you in ways you have never even dreamed of. You would be compensated very, very well for this position. I would even go as far as getting you somewhere to live, along with a few other things you would need to get on your feet. There are conditions to this offer. First and foremost, if it is ever revealed that you speak to anyone about this company, what we do, or where we are located, we will make you disappear. Also, I cannot trust someone who is currently using mind-altering chemicals to work for me. If you choose this option, I will make sure you are detoxed comfortably. After that, if I have the suspicion you have begun using again, I will drug test you. And again, if it comes up positive, you will disappear. The second option is that I have my men blindfold you again and bring you directly back to where they picked you up, and you will never see any of us again. Please make sure you are certain of your decision before selecting an option. Jake sat there absolutely stunned at what he had just heard. "Can I ask any questions about the job?" Jake replied. "You may not," said the boss. "If I tell you too much about what we do, I will not be able to safely let you return to your life." Jake sat there for a few minutes longer, and then agreed to take the job. The boss thanked him for his choice, and said that he thought they could both greatly benefit from the decision. Jake began asking questions about the job, but was quickly cut off by the boss. He told Jake that the only thing he needed to focus on for now was getting through the next week. He informed Jake that he would be brought to an apartment, where he was to remain for the next week while he detoxed. He said he would be provided with medication that he would be able to take one time per day. This medication would take away his detox symptoms. Once he was done with the first week and showed some commitment to the plan, he would be brought back to the office and everything would be explained to him. Although Jake was feeling a great deal of reluctance and didn't fully trust the boss, he agreed. He was once again blindfolded, driven for a period of time, and brought to the new location. It was a totally normal looking apartment. It was furnished, but looked as if no one had been living there. The man that drove him handed him a pill. He wasn't able to tell Jake exactly what it was, only that it would make him feel better. Jake was still fearful that the next several days would be torture, like every other time he detoxed. But to his surprise, he felt nothing. He felt no symptoms of the withdrawal. The week went by, and he got through it without any real problems. Once the week was up, he was driven back to meet up with the boss. Except only this time, he wasn't blindfolded. He was brought back to the same office, where the boss greeted him and asked him to have a seat. He began talking to Jake. "First of all, congratulations for getting through the detox. You should be proud. Let me explain to you what it is we do here, and more specifically, what I hired you for. On the outside, we are just a regular company that manufactures parts for various types of engines. We own several warehouses, and then this location, which is our administrative building. Every other floor of this building is filled with legitimate employees for my legitimate business. None of them know anything about what happens on this particular floor. It's called the executive floor, and without a certain key to using the elevator, you can't get up here. The other employees believe this is just for security purposes. My legitimate business does fairly well, but I would barely break even if I had to rely on it only. It's essentially nothing more than a cover. Jake, are you familiar with the deep web?" After Jake shook his head no, the boss continued. "It's essentially a part of the internet that you are unable to locate unless you use a particular browser. All activity on the deep web is nearly impossible to trace, especially for us because of the equipment we have. Therefore, the deep web has lots of vendors offering illegal things such as drugs and weapons. But then there's us. On the deep web, we are known simply as the Anything Company. The reason we are called that is precisely because that's what we offer, anything the customer wants. The business model is simple. A customer of ours submits a request for a service or product online through our website on the deep web. It can be for literally anything they want, from drugs that are no longer available anymore, such as Quaaludes, to an assassin, to any service imaginable. We are the company that provides the things that no one else can. Once a customer submits a request, it goes to our financial department. They are the individuals who work along with our research department to issue the customer a quote for whatever it is they are requesting. From there, the quote is sent back to the customer along with instructions to how the customer can send payment to our financial department. Once the payment is received, that's where you come in. You will be one of our field agents. Your job will be to pick up and deliver goods to customers, or carrying out whatever service they asked. Now, there are times we have to deny services. For example, if a customer asks us to give them the power to fly, that's simply not possible. But if there's any way whatsoever we can fulfill the customer's request, no matter what it means, we do it. If you are ever arrested doing anything illegal for a customer, you do not speak a word of this to the authorities. We will use our vast resources to get you out of any position that you might end up in. If you do speak of the company to the authorities, just know, we have resources everywhere, including any jail or prison you may find yourself in. You are going to be given very specific directions anytime you have to carry out a job. You already have a home. You will also be given a car, a phone, and some money that you'll need for the time being. I know you must have some questions about this, and those will be answered soon enough. For now, the only thing you need to do is await further instruction. You can go home for now or do anything else you'd like. Just remember, you are always on call. Jake was absolutely stunned at what he had just heard. If anyone else in the world would have told him about a company like this, he would not have believed them. But after seeing this nice office building and the cars out front, along with whatever he was given for his detox, he knew it was all true. He was given a cell phone, cash, and keys to the elevator, his new car, and his new apartment. Jake decided he would go get something to eat and wait at home for his first assignment. Despite knowing the consequences, he still found himself battling the urge to go get high, but he refused to give in. He couldn't believe the turn of events. Only a week ago, he was waking up in a cold, abandoned house, just living from one high to the next. And now, he seemed to have just about everything he could want. He started playing all sorts of scenarios through his head of the different things a customer could request that he might have to do. Some of the ideas were horrifying to him, but he kept himself preoccupied and knew that he was committed. The very next day, his phone rang. It was time for him to fulfill his first order. The order seemed pretty mild compared to the horrible things he was thinking of the night before. The customer had requested a certain drug that was otherwise unattainable for them. All Jake had to do was go pick it up and drop it off at a predetermined location. Once it was dropped off, the customer would only then be notified of where this location was. The research department had located the item, and the financial department had already made payment to whoever it was that was supplying it. All Jake had to do was go pick it up and drop it off somewhere else. After that, he would simply let the financial department know when he was done, and they would send what was called a receipt to the customer, which would give them directions on how to obtain their item. It seemed simple enough, but Jake was worried about what type of person he was going to have to meet in order to pick up the package. He was picturing some sort of mob boss or something. He first had to drive 800 miles to pick it up, then another 700 to the drop-off location, and then finally back home. He spent the next couple days doing a lot of driving. When he got to the address he was given, he was surprised to find a very ordinary-looking warehouse. He walked into the office and gave them the name he was told to give to pick up the package. They brought it out to him, and that was it. It was absolutely nothing even similar to what he was expecting. He drove and drove some more, left the package at the spot he was told to, called the financial department, and that was it. Although it was a ton of driving and a bit boring, he couldn't believe how easy it just was. He was absolutely delighted that he was being paid so much to do something like this. Once he finally made it back home, he got some well-needed sleep. His next job was a bit more tricky. A woman was worried that her husband was having an affair. Originally, the woman hired a private investigator, but being bound by certain laws, he was only able to look into the man so much and found nothing. This time, the woman wanted a tap to be put on the man's work phone, which was the phone she suspected her husband of using to contact his mistress with. She also wanted a device to be put on his work computer to track everything he was doing on it. Jake was given specific instructions on where the man's work was, which office was his, when and how to gain entry to the building, and the devices he would need to attach to the man's phone and computer. Once again, Jake found himself doing a good bit of driving just to get to the man's place of work. From there, with all the tools he was given, it was easy. He used something called taps to get in the main door. Taps were basically a small device one would literally tap into the keyhole of a lock. The lock itself would shape the tap into the same size and shape as the key needed to unlock it. Jake also had a small electrical device that would disarm any known type of security system. He wore gloves and a mask, of course, and with the proper tools and very specific directions, he was in and out of the man's place of work within minutes, completely undetected. At this point, Jake was feeling better and better about his new profession every day. He even reunited with his parents a couple weeks into it, telling them he got cleaned up and was given an office job at the legitimate part of his boss's company. His parents saw how much better he looked compared to when they last saw him, and they were thrilled. Jake continued to be given orders and continued making money. But then came something Jake was afraid of. He knew that sooner or later, he would be the next available field agent when this request came in, and that it was only a matter of time until he would have to do it. Coincidentally enough, it turned out to be the same woman that thought her husband was cheating on her requesting it. The woman wanted the Anything Company to assassinate the mistress her husband had. Apparently, after reviewing the information from the devices left on her husband's computer and phone, she was able to confirm her suspicions. Not only that, but she gathered enough information to find out exactly who her husband was having an affair with. It was possible that the mistress didn't even know the man had a wife, or that the husband would just find another mistress once this one was gone. But the Anything Company wasn't there to give people advice or to tell them what to do. The Anything Company was there to give the customer anything they paid for. So after being given the tools, information, and very specific directions, Jake once again found himself on the road, headed to his next job. He was really not looking forward to carrying this task out, but he knew he had no choice. He wanted to know as little about this woman as possible, just enough to get the job done, nothing more. He finally made it to his destination, and the next morning, as per his directions, he began tailing the woman. This was his first job where he would have to use his own discretion, rather than specific directions, to complete the objective. The directions told him to locate the woman, which was easy since he had pictures of her, along with her address and place of work. From there, they stayed to tail the woman and learn her schedule. Once he was familiar with her routine, he was directed to pick a location to finish the job. It had to be a location that he had a clear view of, from at least a quarter mile away. He was given a long-range rifle that had a silencer with it. As long as he stayed out of view from everyone and kept a bit of distance, he should be able to pull it off rather easily. After a day of following the woman, he felt confident that he knew where she was going to be the next day. That same evening, he checked out the parking lot she parked in for work, and after about an hour of driving from place to place, he found a location that was pretty far away, but had a clear view of where she would be at. When tailing her earlier in the day, he noticed that the woman had to use a badge to get in the front door of her place of work. So during that several second period when she paused to swipe her badge, he would take her out then. Jake had taken the gun for shooting practice and was familiar with how it worked, but he was far from an expert and thought that having a stationary target would be best. He got to his location the next morning, about a half hour before he believed the woman would show up for work. The woman showed up right around the time he had anticipated, at which point he got out his rifle and aimed it at the door. He took a deep breath and put his finger on the trigger, repeating in his head over and over that he had no other choice but to go through with this. The woman came into view, he locked in on his target, and pulled the trigger. Right as he saw the woman fall to the ground, he realized how big of a mistake he had made. Despite of how much detail he put into being prepared, he forgot one of the most crucial things, putting the silencer back onto the rifle after practicing with it that day before. There was now a ringing that screamed through his ears, and he knew that although he was in a spot that was out of view from everyone, countless people must have just heard the gunshot. In a panic, Jake threw the rifle into the trunk of his car and took off from the area as quickly as possible. He cursed at himself for being so stupid as he sped down back streets, trying to put as much distance between him and the woman as possible. Eventually, he finally felt like he was out of danger and pulled over to collect his thoughts. He called in like normal to confirm that the job had been completed. He drove for several more hours before pulling over to get a motel for the night. He did feel bad for what he did, but he kept telling himself he had no choice. If he had refused to do it, not only would a different agent end up doing it anyway, but Jake himself would have died along with the woman. 3 hours into sleeping, Jake was woken up to his phone ringing. He had no desire to wake up or answer, but he knew he was always on call. As expected, it was the office calling. It turned out, against all odds, the woman he took care of earlier had survived. Within 5 minutes, Jake was out of bed and on his way back to the location he had just fled from earlier. With new instructions and information in hand, he was ordered to complete his task. After picking up a pair of scrubs and a surgical mask, he inconspicuously made his way into the city hospital's side door, up the stairwell to the third floor, and proceeded to room 3108. Jake found himself uncomfortable walking around with a loaded syringe containing 300 milligrams of morphine given his past, but the threat of certain death kept him focused on his objective. The woman, already in critical yet stable condition, was unconscious when he entered her room. He quickly injected the morphine into her IV line, flushed it with saline, and made his way out of the hospital as quickly as possible before the woman's respiratory arrest caused her heart to stop and set off the alarm on her monitor. Weeks went by, and regardless of how crazy Jake's career was, he was feeling himself gaining more and more control over his life. Regular meetings with the boss confirmed how well his progress was being received, and then came the day where he faced his first real challenge. By this point, Jake had gotten to know everyone that he worked with on the executive floor rather well. They didn't share personal details of their lives with one another, but they still developed relationships. This is the same reason that made things so difficult for Jake when he was recruited to be on the asset recovery team. This particular team was designed for one and one reason only. Several agents would be recruited to this team to complete a single task, and once completed, they would go back to taking regular jobs. The task itself was quite simple compared to many others, but it still had its unique twist. The asset recovery team is recruited when an agent of the Anything Company violates the terms of service they are given, and therefore must be removed. It was painful for Jake to be a part of this, as he's grown quite fond of most of the individuals he's worked with. When Jake and his two associates showed up and caught the man off guard, he knew what he was in for. He didn't put up a fight. He accepted his fate, and it was a clean, quick job. A single bullet to the brainstem, a body wrapped in plastic and transported to a secluded area where a pre-dug hole was waiting, and then that was it. Jake learned that night just how serious violating the terms of his employment really was. It was one thing to be told about it, but it was completely different to see it firsthand. It was after this night that Jake started to think about an exit strategy. The allure of the job started to disappear. The money suddenly became not worth it. He almost began to envy his old pathetic life. The idea of living by himself in a cold abandoned house, addicted to drugs, somehow still seemed safe and preferable when compared to his current situation. As of now, he had saved up quite a remarkable amount of money from the jobs he has completed. On his own time, he began looking into starting a new life, somewhere far, far away. He began corresponding with those from Belize. He had enough money to live there for probably the rest of his life. He pictured himself enjoying the weather and spending the rest of his life fishing and snorkeling. The economy there was surprisingly stable. Maybe he would start a small business there with the money he had saved up. Jake put his plan in motion. It wasn't difficult for an American with money to move to a place like Belize. Anyone offering to bring money to a place like that was welcome with open arms. Even better for Jake, his money was saved up in cash form. Day by day, Jake continued carrying out tasks, but secretly, in his free time, he was planning his escape. The Anything Company went from something amazing that saved his life to something horrible and ugly. The agent that Jake and his colleagues terminated violated the conditions. That much is true. What condition did he violate? He eventually came clean to his wife about what he really did for work at the Anything Company. His wife was in disbelief. She literally didn't believe him. All of the suspicious activity he was involved in, all of the traveling and all of the late nights, she was sure he was having an affair. His marriage was falling apart, and eventually, in an attempt to save his marriage, he came clean to his wife. Not believing the man's claims, the wife began digging for information. Not satisfied with the information she was given, she eventually followed her husband one morning on his way to the office. While there, she asked too many questions and revealed what her husband had told her. Jake and two other agents took care of the husband, while one other agent took care of the wife. That is all it took. A secret being let out and questions being asked, equated to two individuals having their lives ended. Jake couldn't take it anymore. As careful as he's been thus far, he knew it was only a matter of time before he accidentally slipped up and somehow violated one of the many, many terms he was given. But Jake continued on working like everything was normal. He couldn't show any signs of wanting to leave. He completed his tasks and finally had everything set up for his escape. He was going to wait until he had his next job. The company would believe he was en route to wherever the job led him, but instead, Jake would be grabbing the bag he had packed and getting on an airplane. He knew he would need to leave his phone and any other electrical devices behind so he wouldn't be tracked. Jake had all of his bases covered and waited for his next call. He didn't have to wait long, of course, as the Anything Company stayed busy and had a shortage of active field agents. Jake received the phone call and was told to come to the office for further instructions. This was a bit odd, but he wasn't too concerned. Like always, he dropped what he was doing and got into his car. Upon arriving at work, the boss called him into his office. When Jake walked in, the boss and another agent named Brock were waiting for him. The boss told him, "Jake, this is an unusual call for us, but it's not the first time we've gotten this request. Usually, as you know, we avoid direct contact with any of our customers, but we always make sure to provide anything they want as long as it's humanly possible for us. This isn't a preferable job to go on, but you happen to be the next available agent, so it's yours." "So what do I have to do?" Jake asked. The boss continued, "This customer is suicidal, but they don't want to end their own life. They want us to perform a certain type of euthanasia for them." The boss then pulled out a box cutter and set it on the desk, sliding it towards Jake. "The customer wants their life ended by having someone cut their throat, and you, Jake, happen to be that someone. Due to the risk being involved by you meeting a customer face to face, Brock will be coming with you just for safety purposes. He will be armed, just with a small 9mm for your safety. I have the directions you need right here. The customer is a 6-hour drive from here. We will contact them now to give them your ETA. Report back when the task has been completed. The customer is paid an almost record-setting amount of money for this task. I've also explained it to Brock, so you guys need to make sure everything is perfect." Jake was disappointed with this task, to say the least. He had killed before, but the idea of cutting someone's throat seemed like such an intimate, awful way of killing someone. Even worse, Brock would be coming with him. He would have to wait until after the task was completed to finally make his escape. Once done, he would drop Brock off and go to the airport. He didn't care which flight he would need to take. He would take multiple flights to end up in Belize if he had to. He certainly had the money for that. Just one more task, one more job, and he would wash his hands of all of this. He would disappear and live happily, and more important, he would be free. Jake and Brock drove to the customer's location. The drive seemed longer than Jake expected, but that could be due to the fact that the two of them barely spoke a word to one another the entire trip. Finally, they reached the customer's house. The two of them walked up to the back door and knocked as instructed. The customer happily greeted the men. He looked to only be in his 30s. He had a nice home in a nice area. Jake couldn't imagine why this man wanted to die. But he also would never understand why anyone would want to actually end their lives, regardless of their situation. The customer led the men to his den, where the three stood and talked for a bit. Finally, the customer said, "Well, let's get to it, shall we?" Jake's heart was racing. It just felt so wrong to him. But just like every other job, Jake knew he had no choice. He removed the box cutter from his pocket and unfolded it, getting it ready for use. Holding it in his hand, he gently rubbed his finger over the blade, discovering just how sharp it really was. Jake looked over at the customer and said, "Are you sure about this?" With a giant smile on his face, the man replied, "Yes, absolutely. I've wanted to see this my entire life." "You wanted to see what?" Jake asked. Suddenly, Brock interrupted, saying, "I'm sorry, Jake, but you are the next agent on the list." Brock pulled out his gun and pointed it at Jake. Brock continued by saying, "My instructions were to come with you, Jake, and if you refuse the job, I am directed to kill you. Once you are dead, I will then go kill your parents and any other family we can find. And just keep in mind the resources we have in our research department." Still confused, Jake said, "Calm down, Brock. I know what I'm supposed to do, and I'm gonna do it." The customer then cut in and said, "Good, because I paid a lot of money for this, more than I spent on my house. I've always wanted to watch someone live, in person, bleed to death, after they slit their own throat."